Amen. All right, so this morning we are going to continue our series, Tell Them I Love Them. If you were here last week, I started the series talking about how when I first started in ministry, one of the things that I always ask God is, what do I say when I get up to speak? Because I don't know if you've ever spoken in front of crowds, most people, do you know that actually the worst fear in life over death is public speaking? People would rather die than speak on a platform. So this morning, what I thought I'd do is invite someone up here to come. No, I'm just kidding. All right, so I love this. This is what's weird. I don't get like knots in my stomach or anything. Like I'm wired for it. I actually truly enjoy it. I don't want to die. So I don't fit the statistic. I want to keep preaching and stay alive. But when I first started, I didn't know what to say. And so I'd be like, God, what do I tell people? And I remember one day specifically, God said to me the words, tell them I love them. And so getting ready for February and Love Month, who had Valentine's this week? Yeah, come on, anybody get anything good? Oh, so, all right, we got one woohoo. My wife didn't even say woohoo. She said, let me just tell you why she didn't say woohoo. Because I am a romantic man. Isn't that right? One year, good for you. She said, one year, I got her this beautiful bracelet to match this ring I had gotten here the year before. Thought, you know, you get the sets, you know, you get the bracelet to match the ring. And she took it back. So this year, I went over to Marsh on Tuesday morning when I realized it was the 14th and she was already gone to work. Whoops. And I went into Marsh. And I was taking donuts anyways up to Riverview School, and I was taking muffins to some nurses at the hospital, and so I was going to get Kels some roses. I don't know if y'all have looked at roses lately.
And they just die.
They just die. I mean, I'm like $59.99. I love this woman, but she would much rather me buy a new pair of shoes or something. And so I bought her some poppies for $8.99. And this is not a lie. By the time I got to the hospital, I had the worst headache from the smell of those poppies. And I took them into the hospital, and they're all wrapped pretty, you know, and she opened them up, and she didn't even bring them home because she had a headache from the break room where they sat all day because they were terrible. So that's why my wife didn't go, woohoo! Usually she gets roses, but we have a kid now, and I didn't remember to order them. And so but they were tulips. Those weren't poppies? Tulips? I had no idea. I think the sign said poppies. All right, so this morning, we're going to continue talking about the love of God for us in connection with how we love each other. And so if you're here this morning and you've never been in an intimate relationship with another human being, you've never like loved someone at a deep level, you might be like, I don't know how I can understand this. Just bear with me because you will understand it because it's the way in which you communicate and how God loves you and how you love God. But I'll use a lot of references this morning from my own life. And so my poor wife is just here on the front row. And if she starts giving me the eyes, then I'll change stories, okay? Sound good. Deal. Deal. All right, cool. Also, quick shout out to those watching on Facebook Live. Thank you guys for tuning in. If you want more information about our church, you can click on Facebook there, or you can go to our website, visitgodshouse.com. Ding. I feel like we need like a little... Cool. All right, so we're going to look at a book this morning in the Bible that a lot of people don't think is very great for church. We're going to look at the book of Song of Solomon. So if you got your Bible, woo! All the church people are like, yeah! I don't get in trouble for this one. Turn to Song of Songs or Song of Solomon, depending on your version, chapter 8. And we're going to start reading there this morning. If you are not accustomed to church or you don't know the Bible very well, when I say the book of Song of Songs, you are like, cool, whatever. Those people that went, woo, are because they know that Song of Solomon is the raciest book in the Bible. There are some things in there that you can't read in a PG-rated church. And I say PG because we're not really a G-rated church. We're kind of a PG-rated church. But there's some things in Song of Solomon you can't even read in a PG-rated church. And so I'll leave those to you. If you want to study it out, have yourself a good time. But we're going to look this morning at verses 6 and 7 in chapter 8. And this is two lovers that are talking back and forth to each other. So this is not what I want to start with this morning. I found this out in some research and talking with a friend. Did you guys know, those of you that do know the Bible and Song of Songs and Song of Solomon, that a lot of people think this was a love letter written between God and the church? But actually, it wasn't. It was actually two lovers who loved each other and wanted to talk about their own life. I mean, I guess I can say sex in church, right? Like, it's legal. Anyway, so they wanted to talk about their sex life and in the way they loved each other in such a great way. Anybody uncomfortable yet? This is so fun, actually. I wish you could see your faces. I just said sex in church, and you all like, oh, gosh. I don't know if you know, but that's how you got here. It's all good. And so the correlation in Song of Songs, even the way that I was always taught, was that I think what we were trying to do in the church is tone it down so it wasn't so racy to be like, no, this is how God loves you. Here's the deal. There are some things in this book that you don't want God to love you that way. He don't love you that way. That's not how it works. This is the love relationship between two people and the intimate relationship they have. But in that, there are some really beautiful pictures of love that we can pull out of how God loves us. So that's where we're going this morning in Song of Songs chapter 8. We're going to start in verse 6. It says, place me like a seal over your heart, like a seal on your arm, for love is as strong as death. Its jealousy unyielding as the grave. It burns like a blazing fire, like a mighty flame. Many waters cannot quench love. Rivers cannot wash it away. If one were to give all the wealth of his house for love, it would be utterly scorned. Love is intense. Love is deep. And the love that we share between two people who are in an intimate relationship is a great example of how much God loves you. And so this morning, what I want to talk to you about is the intimate love of God for you. He loves you in such an intimate way that the relationship that he longs for with you is one that he doesn't have with anyone else. You are unique in who you are, and he says, my love for you is so great that it cannot be quenched. The streams that would flow, what's the verse say with streams? I love that phrase. I just kind of circled around that table. That was real graceful. Many waters cannot quench love. How many of you guys know the kind of love with another human being where it's just like you have gone through floods, you've gone through hell, you've gone through things in that relationship where it should have put out that flame, but it didn't, because that love is so strong. That's the kind of love that God has for you. And so we're going to get in and take some notes right at the beginning this morning and go through some stuff here. If you're taking notes, first thing you can write down we're going to talk about is that the intimate love of God brings bravery. The intimate love of God brings bravery. I was thinking through this week about this message and how much God loves us and how much he loves me, how much he loves you, and what he desires in a love relationship with us. And I thought, Lord, what is it that it does for me to know how much you love me? Because I'm very aware that with as many people as here this morning, not all of you have had an intimate relationship with God or another person, especially one that was healthy, right? And so a lot of times when we talk about intimacy in church, or we talk about things of the love of God or the love for each other, immediately all these past things come up of hurt and abuse and things that should have pushed you away from God and not closer to God. And so what I want to build this morning is a foundation to let you understand that an intimate relationship with God is not anything of what you've seen portrayed poorly in intimacy, and it's everything good about a solid, intimate relationship. The Bible says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And then he says that perfect love drives away fear. And so if you're in a relationship with someone and that person is putting you in a place of fear, that's not love. And so if you're in a relationship with what you have as an idea of God, and you are pushed into a place that's not conviction, that's different. There's times that God might convict you of something you're doing wrong or something you said or someone you need to go apologize to, but it's done in a loving way. But if you have this picture of your relationship with God and it's rooted in fear, that's not the true love of God for you. The true love of God doesn't bring fear. It brings bravery. A few years ago, Kelsey and I were on vacation with some friends. Someone actually had blessed us and given us a cruise to the Caribbean, which was the first time I've ever been to the Caribbean. It was a whole lot of fun. We got on this cruise ship, which, you know, if you've cruised before, it's fun, I guess. I mean, I don't know. We've done it a couple times. I like it, but it's kind of weird because it's like you put a whole city on a boat and you live together for a week and call it vacation. I don't know. Personally, I'd rather just go up to Lake Michigan and be out in a little cottage alone when I go on vacation, but that's just me. Anyway, but we enjoy going with this group of friends we have that we've traveled with, and so we go to Grand Cayman Island, and if you've ever been to Grand Cayman, it's the most beautiful water you've ever seen. I'm talking like crystal blue water. And we get to Grand Cayman, and we signed up for this snorkeling experience where you could go snorkeling and see the water and see the what are they called? A shipwreck, that's what it was, a shipwreck with all the fish people, you know, fish and whales and whatever is in the ocean. Now I'm a Michigan boy, and in Michigan, we love water. I'm just being real. That's right, John, we're Michigan guys. Like everything we do in life in Michigan, especially from April until October, revolves around water. That's what we do. However, I'm not a big ocean person because I don't like to go in water that can eat me. It's just my theory. I also learned that I don't like to go in water that's salty. I don't drink salt water for fun, so why do I want to swim in it? You may say, well, why do you drink the water you're swimming in? That's a whole other story. Coordination is the issue. And so we get on this big boat, and there's like hundreds of people on this boat, and we're gearing up, and they're putting on the snorkel gear, and we get out to the area where the shipwreck is, and we're going to jump into this water. And so I'm a little bit scared, but I'm trying to act like I'm not, because I'm there with my wife and my brother and his wife, and we're going to be all, you know, like, I got this, we're good. And so I jump into that ocean going, dear Jesus, please don't let me get bit. I don't want to get bit. I don't want to die. I don't want to die. I don't want to die. And smiling on the outside. Which is kind of a story of my life a lot of times anyways. But so we jump into the water, and we start swimming around, and it was beautiful. It was absolutely the most beautiful water experience I've ever had, if you could take away the salt, honestly, because the salt's getting all in your mouth. It's just gross. And so I'm like, I'm going to have a heart attack from the sodium increase in this thing. And so we're swimming around, and we see the ship, and we swim down towards the ship, and you see when Nemo was there and Dory, and it was just beautiful, and all the little fishies. And then Kelsey had gone away because she's a little more adventurous than me, and my brother also is a little more adventurous. My brother's wife, who was my best friend in college, who introduced Kelsey and I, we're kind of the same person, just the male and female version. So we're kind of hovering close to the boat in case something happens, and Ryan and Kelsey are out there, and all of a sudden, like 200 people are on this excursion together, and Kelsey yells out, "Shark!" And so like a good husband, I jump back on that boat so fast. I was like, someone's got to live in this relationship, and she's got life insurance. This is great. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, well, I'm not kidding about the jumping on the boat part. Okay, so I jump back on the boat, and literally Amy and I both jump on the boat, and Ryan and Kelsey swim towards the shark. So here's the thing. I don't know if there actually ever was a shark. But she yelled shark so much, and I learned in that moment that when I get into an ocean, there is so much fear in me that there might be beauty all around me, and I'm looking at the fish, and I'm looking at the shipwreck, and I mean, this is Caribbean blue water, but the minute an ounce of fear is even talked about, I'm done. And I think that's how some of us have lived our lives and our intimate relationship with God. His love has not made us braver. It's made us think that we're in beauty and it's beautiful and it's all great. But the minute we get 1 ounce of something in life that might make us afraid, we bail. And we're like, God doesn't love me like that. Because if he really loved me, he wouldn't let sharks flow into the sea. And if he really loved me, then I wouldn't deal with tension and my relationships wouldn't be hurting. And if he really loved me, I wouldn't go through what I'm going through. But the reality is God doesn't give you fear, but he gives you the courage to overcome the fear that you face in your life. And when you know him in a way like you know another person, like the way I know Kelsey, where I can look at her and I know she was not offended that I didn't go out and try to save her. Because most of the time when it involves water, she's saving me. We first got married. I just told you I'm going to tell stories today. We first got married. She wanted to swim across the lake. Now, who wants to swim across the lake, first off? But she was a lifeguard, and she played water polo, so she's a water girl. When I say I'm a water boy from Michigan, I mean we like boats. That's what I mean. Okay, I like to be on the water. I like cottages that look at water. I have no desire to be in the water. That's what a pool's for, all right? So she decides we're going to swim across this lake. And I was like, well, you know, we just got married. I was a lot more in shape at that point. And so I thought, I'll swim across the lake with you. This would be fun. And we got out, what, 50 yards maybe? And I freaked out. Like, I mean like freaked out like a baby. Like, I was like, oh, Kelsey, oh, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. And so Kelsey is holding me in the middle of this lake going, breathe. We're going to get back to shore. And she had to put her lifeguard instincts to pull me back to shore. And I sat up on the lake getting over my panic attack, and she swam across and I watched. So she was not, because we know each other, she was not offended that I jumped back on the boat and didn't come off to save her, because she's independent enough and she'll save herself. She's not afraid of the sharks. She'd probably take the shark down. You don't want to double cross this woman. Not really. But anyways. But the reality is, the love that I share with her lets me know that I can go through anything and face any fear. The love we share does not bring fear to me. It helps drive fear out of me. That's what an intimate relationship with God will do for you. Another thing that you can write down is that the intimate love of God brings vulnerability. This is a word that I didn't know a lot about, honestly, until I moved to Marion and met Megan Gilmore and Lark Song. And then I realized that half of Marion knows what vulnerability is. I didn't grow up in a culture of vulnerability. I grew up in a culture of fake it till you make it. And if it bothers you, you just kind of push it under the rug until the rug is so high that you're tripping yourself and everybody else around you, right? I didn't grow up in a place where I thought I could be really me. It's not because of the way my parents were. I had great parents. It was the culture that we were raised in, and we didn't even talk about our feelings and how we feel. But when I look at the love of God in relation to me and how God loves me, what I've learned about his love is I can be fully me and he's cool with it. He's cool with it. He doesn't want a version of me. He wants me. I was meeting with a person who's become a friend of mine now, and she actually has been my life coach and coaching me. And we were meeting a few weeks ago, and we were standing in this sanctuary because she likes to take her clients to a place where, like, you do a lot of work. And so she brought me here and onto this platform, and she had just started asking me questions around what this is to me. And what is Sundays, and what is church, and what is leadership, and all this. And what I came to is I was trying to figure out what I was trying to figure out. You know, you're like, I don't know what I really feel here, and I'm not really sure what this is. And at one point, she stopped me, and she said, DJ, I feel like what you try to do is give people a picture of who you think you should be. And then she said this, because my life coach loves Jesus. She goes, God did not call you to Marion to give people a picture of who you think you are. He called you because you're you. And something in me was like, oh, shoot. Like every time that I try to talk to someone in a conversation or I try to have an experience with someone and I try to act like I'm not who I am because I'm afraid that you might not want to receive who I really am, I'm actually demeaning God because God says, I put you where you are because I created the real you. And the love that he shares for you and I is because he loves you right like you are because that's how he created you to be. So vulnerability is a word that has become really strong in my life and one that I'm fighting every day to become more real, more true to who I am. And this last year in relationship to Kelsey, one of the things I've shared before, but I had a bout, I would say, or a strong struggle with anxiety. And I've had this struggle for a long, long time, but I never would admit it because I didn't know how to be vulnerable. So I acted like I didn't, and I smiled all the time, and I acted like everything was good, when in reality, in my head, for like 10 years, I never knew what it felt like to be happy. Can I just be real? I didn't know what it felt like to not have knots in my back all the time, to not have a lot of issues in the inside of my system because of the way I felt. And I would have people pray over me. Like one time, like eight different groups in 1 week prayed over me and anointed me with oil, and nothing happened. And then I was like, well, what am I supposed to do? I still feel this, and it's not going away. And so I just didn't deal with it for a long, long time. And then this last summer, I had this experience where it got really, really bad. And I didn't want to tell anyone, and so I was acting like it was good, right? That's what we do. We act like it's all good. And I got to this point last July where something in me broke. And one night, laying in bed, I just started crying. Now, here's the thing about vulnerability. If I didn't trust Kelsey and know that she'd have my back no matter what, and that she'd stay with me through thick and thin and through better or worse, the song we sang this morning, right? Like to have and to hold, richer or poor. If I didn't think that she would still be there when I exposed what was really going on in my life, I never would have gotten to the place where I started addressing the issue in my life. I would have said, oh, I'm just having a bad night. But instead, Kelsey starts asking me questions, what's wrong? And I'm like, I don't know what's wrong. I don't know. And I went through this couple weeks long thing where she finally is like, you got to go talk to someone. And if I wasn't in a place with her where I felt that I could be real for me and she could be real with me and we could share real experiences, I would not have had the courage to step out and say, okay, I got to get help. And for some of us, our relationship with God is so fake. We act like one thing when we're in front of people or even with God. We were taught how to pray, right? And we're like, oh, thee, thou most holiest, grandiose, creator of the universe, wouldst thou comest to mine house. Right? Sometimes we're taught to pray all these prayers in such incredible ways, and there's some beauty. There's so much beauty to having a prayer journal. We had a guy here Tuesday night that was teaching us how to pray through, I forget what the one experience was called, but it was this beautiful way of like getting your mind to repent and your heart to repent and then thanking God for who he is. And there's some beautiful things you can do with prayer, but what that experience brought was vulnerability. It didn't bring fakeness. And what happens sometimes in our lives is we try to convince God that we are something that we're not, and you can't joke a joker, right? Like, you can't kid a kidder. Like, he created you. He knows who you are. And so when you come to him and you're like, God, my life is so amazing, but if you could just maybe help me get a job, that would be so good because you're so amazing. Yeah, God's like, aw. Why don't you come to me and be like, God, I'm broke as a joke. I need a job. I can't stand it anymore. My marriage is on the rocks because of it. I can't eat. I need a job now. David did that. David got in God's presence. David had an incredible, intimate relationship with God. And he got into a point and he's like, God, send blessing now. That's not real like ask, dear Jesus, would you please help me? He's like, send it today. Jacob wrestled with God. Why? Because he had a relationship with God that was so intimate that God's like, let's fight this thing out. And we come in and we're like, Jesus, now I lay me down to sleep. If I die, I'm like, if I die, I'm praying with my kid. If I die, you ain't dying. I will live and not die to declare the works of the land of the living. You ain't dying, kid. What in the world are we doing to ourselves? Because we put on this fake facade for God, and God's like, all I want is you. All I want is you, just like all Kelsey wants is me. We were driving up to Michigan the last couple days. We were up there for a wedding, and on the way up there, she said to me, can I just share this? I will anyways. She'll know what I'm going to say. She's like, we were talking through some feeling type stuff in our relationship, you know? Like, anybody ever talk about feelings? It's a good thing. And I'm a feeler, so I talk about feelings a lot, and she tends to be like, can we please stop talking about your feelings, for the love of God? But she goes, well, it's funny how I'll hear you say things when you speak that I don't know you're going through because you don't tell me. And I feel like I know Kelsey so well that I think she just knows everything going on, and I realize I don't actually tell her everything going on. And then I wonder why she's not sympathetic over a situation, right? Because she has no clue what I'm thinking. But if I were to know, she's got my back no matter what, and I can say anything to her and share with her what I'm going through at the end of a hard day, she now has this mutual respect with me where she's going, okay, now what can I do, and what can you do, and what can I do, and what can you do? That's how God looks at you. He doesn't want you to hide your feelings. He doesn't want you to make up a version of you for him so he thinks you're cool. God don't think you're cool. Actually, God does think you're cool, but he doesn't think the version of you that you created is cool. He thinks right where you are is cool. He wouldn't have made you if it wasn't cool. God doesn't make mistakes. So if you've been told over and over you have to hide who you are and you have to hide all these things because God doesn't like it, God created you. So why not just be the real you and have a relationship with him that says, God, I receive your love, and here I am, all of me, my mess, all of it. Let me just be completely vulnerable with you. Because intimacy with God brings vulnerability. The last one you can write down this morning is that intimacy with God brings trusted companionship. One of the most exciting things to me about marriage, and Kelsey and I have been married almost 7 years. It'll be 7 years this May. And I'm trying to convince her that we need to go on a trip. Because when you hit seven, you're over that hump where the statistically it goes down for getting divorced, right? So the problem is I want to go on like an expensive trip. And if I plan an expensive trip, then we're going to get divorced. I'm just kidding. Not really. But she's like threatening me. Don't you? We are not. It's seven. We'll celebrate seven. She's like, you wait till 10. Then you can get me the upgrade. And I'm like, yeah. Because I don't wait for anything. And then I'll get to 10 and it'll be a cubic zirconian because she won't actually take the real one. But anyways. True. It's true. She don't want it. I want it because I want people to think that I am a great husband. Isn't that, it's pathetic. I'm just being real. Okay, so. But we married 7 years in May, and so we're going to probably end up going to a Holiday Inn Express for a night, and that's how we roll. And so, but with marriage, something that's so great about marriage that I didn't know when I was single, and for all you single people here, here's my word of advice, all right? This is free. Enjoy your singleness. Enjoy it. It's amazing. Because once you get married, it's also amazing. But there's a lot of other things that aren't as amazing as when you're single. Right? All the married people? Amen. You just don't, like, you know, get up at 11 o'clock and think, I want Applebee's. Let's go. Because your wife goes to bed at 9, and she doesn't want you to eat all that sodium before you go to bed. And so now you can't go to Applebee's at 11 o'clock, you know? Like, and so, anyways, I'm just sorry. Was that too close to home? So enjoy it. But here's the beauty. Here's the beauty of an intimate relationship is that you have this companion to do life with. But you notice, I didn't just say the word companion, I said a trusted companion. Because a lot of people are walking around in relationships, and they've got the title, but there's no trust. I think that's sometimes us in the church. I'm a Christian. I've got a relationship with God. Really, what does that relationship look like? Well, I go to church. Church is not your relationship. Church is where we all come together to talk about that relationship. But church is not your relationship. Your relationship with God is the love connection you and he has over and over on a daily basis. And Paul said, pray continually in everything you do. It doesn't mean you're in a super spiritual state everywhere you go. Some people take that verse and think that, right? I'm just going to walk into Walmart praying continually and wonder why no one's talking to me. Right? I'm going to pray these people out of my way. I'm going to pray some cashiers in here. But it's a continual love relationship with God when you're just like, man, God, like, thank you for the opportunity to breathe today. I'm not into the whole, like, I used to be, but, you know, thank you, God, for the rock star parking. You know, I used to be like, favor ain't fair. I got a front row parking spot. God's like, what if you had gone out there and like given that to, you know, a single mom or something? Could have been nice of you, but you know, I'm like, wow. So, but that kind of relationship where God is like your companion, he's your friend. And then that companionship builds a trust that you know you can talk with him about anything, and he knows he can trust you with anything. I think sometimes that we live in a world that's so fast-paced and we glorify so much the big and the bold and the beautiful and all that. That was, you know, big, bold, beautiful. We glorify the glamour, the Hollywood life and our Instagram. Like, we're taking a picture of this wedding last night and I made my sister take 43 because every one of them, my chin was not going away. And I'm like, no, tilt it this way. So if you look at my Instagram, I don't have a double chin. It took a long time to get to that point. And so I'm just, you know, now you know. This is real. Kelsey drives her crazy, but that's just my life. And so my selfie stick is great because you can lean it. People are like, wow. Anyway, so it's all good. Isn't what you think? Thank you. Okay, so anyways, trust the companionship. So we're at this wedding and we're taking pictures, making ourselves look good or whatever. But at the root of our relationship is not an Instagram relationship, right? We glorify all this stuff in our society, like, oh, that's so cool, they got dressed up and they got a cool car and they got this or whatever. But that's not intimacy. That's all a facade. You want to know what trusted companionship is? Yesterday afternoon, Kelsey and I went to the hospital to see my mom. My mom is 55 years old. And for 30-ish years, she's had MS. And as part of her MS, her body deteriorates. And my mom has done really, really well with MS. In fact, she's had times in her life where it's been really bad, and she has, they call a bout with MS, and she gets to the point where she can't walk, and she can't use the bathroom, and she can't see. But for the most part of our life, we've been really blessed that it hasn't progressed quickly. But because of what she has, she continually has health problems over and over and over. And so she just had this hip surgery where they took out her hip because she had had a hip replacement, but the replacement hip got infected. So they took that hip out. They have to give it 3 months to heal to see if the infection comes back before they can even decide if they can put another hip in. So at least she will not be able to walk for 6 months. 6 months. Now, she's had times in her life where she can't walk anyways because of her MS. But now she literally, they said, cannot put pressure on that leg or she just collapsed because there's no structure there. And so we get to the hospital yesterday afternoon after my poor dad. We get to his house Friday night. He had gone down into the basement. They have bedrooms down there. And he went to go make sure the beds were all made and everything for us kids coming to stay for the night. And he steps down into his basement and splashes. And his basement flooded like this deep. Like just ruined all the drywall and the molding and the carpets. Like, so it's probably been wet for a few days because he's been at the hospital with my mom and doesn't know. And so came home to a flooded basement. So we stayed up till like 1 a.m. trying to help him clean it out and clean out the bedrooms. And he's sucking up water, going to Home Depot, buying a new sump pump because the sump pump died. And so he's got all this stuff going on. But yesterday morning, he puts it aside and he goes up to see my mom in the hospital as he's got a house at home where he's trying to figure out what to do with his basement. And he goes and sits next to my mom, and he gets there yesterday, and the rehab people said, you know, in order for her to come home, she can't walk, and your house has stairs, so you got to find a way to even get her in the house. And so we went to have lunch with my dad before the wedding, and I said to my dad, what are you going to do? Are you going to build a ramp? I don't know what I'm going to do, but I have to do something. Because this is my wife. Now, I've told you guys stories of my sister who had cancer and the whole season of watching her walk through that and watching other families walk through it with our family. I would say 9 out of 10 families, those parents ended up divorced with their kid that had cancer because that stress is so much. I don't judge them for that, honestly, because until you walk through it, you can't even understand it. But my parents stayed through all that. And in the midst of that, my dad continued to care for my mom and worked a job that was 80 hours a week and provided a good living for our family and put us kids in private school. I mean, just like he was incredible. And yesterday was one of those days where we're leaving the hospital and we're driving to this wedding. And I said to Kels, I don't even understand my dad. They've been married almost 35 years. And 30 of those years, he's been her caretaker. And a lot of those times, she hasn't had to. But my mom will tell you over and over, and she's one of those people who will tell you over and over, she can't stand having to be the one that's being taken care of. And we're all like, Mom, it's fine. Like we don't even think of it like that because it's how it's always been. And so much of our life wasn't that. It was just in little phases. But in this phase right now, that probably for the next year, she can't even get around on her own. My dad's like, well, this has been great. See ya. He's trying to figure out how to pay to put a ramp on his house that they already built with extra wide doors and stuff so wheelchairs could go through if they have to. He's trying to figure out how to get his wife home in 2 weeks when his kids have all moved to different places, and so he's up there by himself figuring it out, and he's just doing it. He's not complaining. Kelsey is in perfect health, and our basement floods every week or so. And I go down there to bail that water, and I am not very pastorly. Can I just be real? My life is so terrible. Oh, really? Is it that bad? Because my dad's bailing water, buying a new sump pump, paying a company to come suck water out so it doesn't mold the rest of the house. Well, he's got a wife who can't walk in the hospital. That's trusted companionship. That's saying, I'm never going away. That's God in his relationship with you. Doesn't matter what you go through. Doesn't matter what you face. Doesn't matter what you've walked through. He's not going away. He's linked to you. He's like, look, I cannot promise you that you won't go through the fire. But in Isaiah, he says, I will go through it with you, and the fires will not overtake you, and the rivers will not flood you. I am with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. And in a world where we just have this Instagram life where we look around and everything's just kind of like, boom, a moment, and it's great, and it's beautiful, and it's all amazing. I watch as my cousin gave his vows yesterday to his new bride, and the tears that flooded their eyes as they said things like, for better or worse, in sickness and health. And I'm sitting next to my dad, whose wife isn't able to be there because she's at a hospital a half hour away, who basically she has to tell him to leave to go to things like that. That's an intimate relationship. And that's how much God loves you. We see it lived out in each other because he created us to have these kind of relationships. He came up with this whole plan. He came up with us and the way we should love each other because that's how much he loves you. And so the love that God has for you should make you brave. It should make you vulnerable. And it should bring a companionship that says he is a friend that will stick closer than a brother through thick and thin. He's there. You have to know deep down in you that is the love of God for you. Can we pray this morning? God, I thank you for the love you have for us. I thank you, God, for the love that you've allowed some of us to watch in our families, even between our parents or aunts or uncles or friends in our lives who've truly loved each other like you love us. Pray this morning, God, for any person in here who says, I've never, ever, ever experienced that kind of love with another person or with God. I pray even today as they leave here, God, that you would help them to feel your arms wrapped around them in such a great way. Lord, that the fear would just be driven away from them, God. That they would be able to be vulnerable and open up their heart and soul to you and just say, God, this is who I am. Help me to receive your love. And that they today would know, God, that that love relationship that they have with you brings such a trusted companionship that says, we are in this together. There's nothing that can separate us. I thank you, God, that you said nothing can separate us from the love of God. No trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword can come between the love you have for us. And so I pray today that we would receive that love in a great, great way this week, God. and that we would live from a place of love, knowing that if we receive fully your love, we can step into a life, God, that you've called us to, of pouring ourselves out for others around us, because we will give out what we receive. And so I pray today that you'd help us receive your love in an intimate way so we can live from that place and love every person we come into contact with in our week. Thank you for the opportunity to gather here today and to just let you love on us a little bit. Pray as we leave from this place, God, that we would leave as people more full of your love. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Will you stand with me this morning?